Well, yeah. Good evening, everyone. Time being 7 p.m. I'd like to call out of the meeting of the Whittier Vocational Regional High School, meeting of January the 11th, one day after my birthday, just so you know. And the first order of business is we'll salute the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
You get a cupcake with a candle on it.
Yeah, I got a free ice cream at Hard Rock Cafe.
Was this a very important one?
71.
Congratulations.
Thank you. So.
Young man.
I want to wish everybody a happy new year. We're in 2017. And our first order of business, public comment. Anybody wish to approach the school committee? I don't see anybody approaching the podium.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
I move the approval of December 14th minutes of our regular school committee meeting.
Second.
Any questions, deletions, or omissions? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Put your foot down.
Mr. Chairman.
All opposed? Wait, hold it.
What's wrong?
What's going on over there? All opposed?
Move.
I'm being heard, unanimous. Mr. Tucker.
I move the approval of December 14th minutes of executive session.
Second.
Any omissions, deletions? None being heard, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Unanimous. Treasury report, Mr. LaSage.
Second.
Any questions or deletions on the report? None being heard, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Unanimous. We don't have any old business at this particular meeting, so now we move on to our agenda item, reports and communications. Our first up is our student representative, Mr. Ulrich.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Superintendent Lynch, and all other school committee members. Welcome back and Happy New Year. This school year is halfway over and teams and clubs are in full swing of things. The drama club is in rehearsal. They are preparing for the play Working, which is about a man who interviews American workers in many walks of life. This fits well with our school because many of the characters have the same trade as the students are pursuing. There's currently a cast of 35 students, and the CAD department and carpentry is helping out with the production and the sets. The GSA club this month is focusing on identifying reading sources on LGBT themes. They will be selecting novels and discussing them during meetings. The first robotics game challenge has been released. The objective for this year's team is to design, build, program, test, and troubleshoot a robot. The team is working from scratch and must follow strict guidelines. They are very excited and have been staying after school and here on Saturdays to have the robot finished by February 21st. If you would like a better understanding of the game and its challenges, please search Google for the first Robotics 2017 game challenge and a link to a YouTube video will come up. Key Club has been very busy once again. They volunteered at the Santa parades and helped at the Breakfast with Santa at the Salisbury Fire Station. They also helped the Salvation Army by ringing the bell outside of Market Basket for donations. Lastly, they helped at their local Christmas castle where needed families are given toys, clothes, and food. The Multicultural Club has also been helping the community. They collected 60 jackets for the Anton Cleaners Coats for Kids drive. The club members also gave presentations on Puerto Rico and South Korea. They will be also sponsoring the showing of the documentary of Selim, The Bridge, The Ballot. This is in honor of Martin Luther King Jr. Day on January 16th, all are welcome to come. The hockey team, which co-ops with Amesbury High School, has reported a great improvement since the season has started. The coach reports that he is thrilled that we have this co-op and place, as he thoroughly enjoys coaching these athletes who bring a different perspective to the school. Both the Amesbury High School students, athletes, and the Whittier Tech athletes benefit this in many ways. At the present time, the varsity team has 1 win, 4 losses, and 1 tie. They are hoping to improve on their record through the course of the season. The boys are working very hard. At the JV level, they have a similar record at 1 win, 3 losses, and 1 tie. They also have been working very hard. Both teams have improved since they have started back on November 28th. The wrestling team has started their season off strong. They have posted 6 wins and 3 losses. They placed 3rd in the Pentucket Holiday Tournament, finishing 4th out of 22. They have a lot of students participating in the program, and they are improving every day. The boys basketball team is off to a great start as well. They are currently 4-1. The boys have been working hard, battling through minor injuries and illnesses, but they have proved themselves on the court. The girls basketball team is also having a great season, being the top of their league with a 6-1 record. They are hungry for wins and show great chemistry on the court. That is all I have for you today.
That's great. Good report.
That's good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Quick question. Are there women on the wrestling team?
There have been. I'm not sure if there are any this year. They can.
So the meets are co-ed, or they have two?
Yeah, they have co-ed meets.
Oh, they do?
Yeah.
And how are your sports injuries?
Two girls.
My knee is healing up pretty well, actually. I just saw the doctor a week ago, and he said my knee's doing a lot better than he thought it would be.
Excellent. Well, you're young, right?
Yeah. Are you going to do any spring sports? Are you going to be able to?
I'm hoping to be on the baseball team to help my boys get a championship this
year. And your coach, Mr. Bolin, right?
Yes, Coach Bolin.
Well, good. Well, thank you very much. Next on the agenda on the reports and communications is the superintendent's report. Ms. Lynch.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Tonight before you are 2 hires for plumbing instructors for our evening school program. The budget update, the executive subcommittee met earlier this evening to discuss the FY18 budget. At the meeting, we begin with an 8.71% increase, which will be reduced for the next executive subcommittee. At this time, there are 5 communities with an increase in enrollment with no additional choice students at this time. MCAS update, Whittier will be running a free MCAS after school program January 19th through February 2nd for juniors and seniors that need to take the biology MCAS, and January 23rd through February 9th for sophomores in the Title I program. ELL students will be taking the ACSIX exam January 25th through 27th. My update, on Thursday, December 15th, the Whittier Chorus held the holiday concert here at the school. It was a wonderful event and really got us all in the mood for the holiday. On December 16th, I attended the Energy Power meeting at Greater Lawrence Technical High School with Kara Cosmas. There was extensive discussion on solar power and how other vocational schools are taking advantage of this opportunity. This is something Ms. Cosmas and I will continue to research. On Tuesday, December 20th, I met with my mentor, Joan Conley. And tomorrow morning, I will be heading to Marlboro for another day of training through the induction program on strategic planning. On Friday, January 6th, I met with MSBA along with Kara Cosmas, Harry Tarkisian, and school committee member Dick Early. Unfortunately, we were not invited to the next stage of the MSBA process. I want to thank Jack McCarthy and Mac Donovan from MSBA for taking a considerable amount of time with us, touring the building and providing information on what we need to add to next year's statement of interest. I continue to be concerned about the state of our building, most importantly, our electrical, HVAC, and plumbing systems. They are now over 45 years, and we are starting to feel the impact of them breaking down. It's important for the 11 communities that Whittier Tech serves to understand the sense of urgency to repair and replace most of these systems. Over the next year, we will continue to communicate how important it is for us to fix our school and get it ready for the next generation of students. I feel that the school has good bones, but when you get behind the walls, we have some significant issues. So we'll continue to move forward with that for the next school year. If you'll indulge me, this today I read the year review for the staff, and I'd like to read it to you for the year of 2016 here at Whittier. We achieved full iPad immersion when the last class received their devices this year, and we set some technology goals. We built a new guidance suite and had new bleachers installed. We hosted a college and career fair for our juniors and seniors. We invited the League of Women Voters to register student voters. We hosted a safety meeting night for parents and a college night. We committed to ensuring a safe school by participating in ALICE drills and restraint training. We brought back the Pledge of Allegiance as a school-wide morning ritual. During the holiday season, we fed hungry, collecting 748 cans of food. We collected winter coats for those in need. Our students volunteered at the Salvation Army and rang a bell for many cold hours at Westgate Plaza. We donated more than 3,000 to buy Christmas presents for Whittier families that would have had none. Our health occupations teacher, Jane Moskovich, was named YMCA Educator of the Year, and we had three other nominees, Patrick Allen, Elizabeth DeVenny, and Tammy Rogello. Our Key Club hosted two blood drives. Our recycling program collected tons and tons of paper. Students in the United Nations class competed at two UN competitions. The Whittier World Employee Newsletter was launched. Our chorus hosted a winter concert. Drama students and their teachers put on a spring musical, Grease. Hundreds of middle school students attended our discovery program during the month of July. We also ran a summer school and MCAS program during July. We administered the PSAT to 200 juniors and seniors. We gave tours to 1,500 eighth graders. Our students competed in the Skills USA regionals, districts, and nationals and brought home dozens of medals. Hundreds of our students earned industry certifications in their vocational technical areas that will set them apart in the job market. 60% of our seniors have co-op jobs. We prepared students so they will qualify union apprenticeships. Carpentry students won the Furniture Trust competition when they masterly converted junk office furniture into beautiful, useful products. Our students and their teacher won first place overall in the Haverhill Santa Parade for the most amazing float yet. It was an impressive year in sports. The following teams were CAC champions in 2016, softball, baseball, cross country, cheerleading, boys track. In addition, the boys and girls soccer team both had three CAC MVPs. To further inspire our students, we took them on numerous field trips. Marketing students attended a conference at Suffolk University. Journalism students recorded radio commercials at WXRV. UN students and culinary students visited the State House. Freshmen created a TV show at HC Media, and many more. We added two new vocational programs, medical assistant engineering this year. We welcomed new teachers and said goodbye to old friends who retired. We drew hundreds of our students to our night school program. We realized we need to wear earplugs as we hosted pep rallies for our students. We also marveled at the attire during Spirit Week. We welcomed our advisory boards at a fancy annual dinner. We hosted two parent nights. We hosted a mock crash that convinced seniors to be careful out there. We hosted a senior talent show and a senior prom. Middle Fab students built a giant bell for the city of Haverhill and won the Outstanding Commitment to a Community Award. We welcomed freshmen to Whittier on Saturday in May and again applause at the front door on their first day. We nailed the MCAS sophomores, achieving 100% in MCAS and ELA, 97 on math, and 98% on our biology test. Culinary students won first place in the Massachusetts Restaurant Association cooking contest. Carpentry students helped build a playground at Newberry Elementary School. We drew students to a dozen different other after-school programs and kept them engaged. We took senior portraits and built a yearbook. We graduated another class of young adults who made us proud. We wrote our little fingers off on the NES and C reports, and we'll cheerfully continue to write more. I put that. We learned how to use an entirely new assessment system. We set goals and achieved them and completed teacher evaluation binders and somehow stand ready to do it all again. So I thought that was just
That's a nice summary.
Amazing.
That is wonderful.
Really, it's the hard work of the staff that really do everything they can to make this an enriching experience for our students. So. You know, really, it all goes out to them. A couple of things I'd like to let you know about, and more things that we're proud of. The Massachusetts Life Science Center STEM Equipment and Supplies Grant. This grant was for $100,000 for equipment and supplies and $10,000 for professional development. I'm happy to say that we are awarded $109,342,000. So,
wow.
Yes. So this grant will be used to set up a makerspace in the electronics robotics program and in the engineering program. So We were able to receive a lot of equipment and as well as professional development, so we're very happy. People worked very hard for that, so I'm very excited. The other thing, we ordered our food service equipment grant. We were able to receive $6,409 for a double-deck convection oven. So I really want to thank Ron Buccini for all of his hard work and going out to that grant and for us achieving it. So some really good positive news during the budget season is always good. Mm-hmm. Also before you tonight are my goals. I sent you a copy of them for your review. My focus continues to be in three areas. The MSBA project, making sure that eventually our school can get into the pipeline to fix the school for the future. Communication about what is going on at our school, public relations. If anyone wants to be my friend on Twitter, I don't know, do you call it your friend? What do you call it when someone, follow me on Twitter. Follow me on Twitter. Please Trump. Do. Huh?
President.
I know, I hear he likes Twitter. And then also on curriculum. I think we need to continue to look at MCAS 2.0 and what curriculum changes we need to make within the school district to be prepared for that next level of state assessment. So are there any questions I can answer regarding my goals?
Yes.
Well, not a goal, but the MCAS, MSBA project that we didn't get on again, mm-hmm. What were the reasons why we couldn't get on?
We need to show them a sense of urgency.
A sense of urgency?
Right. So we were able, through our tour, be able to get some good information about what we need to make sure is in our next statement of interest. And actually, Ms. Cosmas walked around with her phone and kept leaving notes. But we learned a lot from their visit, and I really can't thank them enough for spending the time. They spent a good two and a half hours with us, touring the building, let us know what we need to make sure that we have for the next statement.
What sorts of things are we supposed to do to show a sense of urgency? I mean, I'm imagining that we have to go around and find something leaking, take massive pictures, show lots of things
well, I think
like that.
There's things like the science lab on the fourth floor that we can show that there's a real need to update those science labs. I think for the meeting earlier this evening, I took pictures of our boilers, of our electricals. You know, when you take a walk through the building,
what's the electrical picture?
It's in the box. When we take a walk through the building, it looks great, but you get behind the walls and there's some significant issues. So
this was not part of our original. We didn't know this before.
There were certain things we did, but they gave us some very good hints about what we need to make for the next one. Title IX.
This is the third time we've tried it.
Mm-hmm. There were, I believe, 79 people that applied, and only 14 people were allowed in. So it's something that we'll continue to work at. But I think we were given some pretty good indications about what we need to do. But in the meantime, we're going to have to fix some things we can't wait to fix. So.
I think it was beneficial that they came, and I think it's not just enough to say we need to upgrade our electrical system.
I understand. This is the third time we've gone at it. I figured we would have learned that from the first.
You're the chair. You're competing with all kinds of districts and schools in the state of Commonwealth of Mass.
Right.
This is a very hard thing to do. We had a major project a few years ago, so we're lucky they even talked to us in a way. I mean, we have to be realistic about it.
Oh, I understand that, but I mean, we're learning that, we should do it this way. If this is the third time. I thought we would have already figured that out.
Well, there were things
we're supposed to do.
That we had discussed and that we had put in, but then when they actually came here and told us what we need to do, for instance, the girls' locker room is smaller than the boys' locker room, certain things like that that we can show. So they gave us some pretty good hints about how we need to make sure that the next one is written.
Who participates in writing the SLA?
Kara Cosmas is basically the leader, but I help, Harry Tarkisian helps, and then our vocational coordinator works to do that.
Mr. Early.
I was at that meeting. We walked around the school.
Really?
Our problem is we've had a preventative maintenance program over the years. A building that's 40 plus years old, and the gentleman that walked around can't believe how clean the place is. Couldn't believe how at cafeteria, one of the cafeteria settings, couldn't believe how quiet it was in there. Walking around during classes, nobody really in the hallway. The only problem that he saw that was out of line is handicap accessibility up in the, I believe it's the auditorium. We've got to go in the back of the auditorium to get people in. Other than that, there's a lot of other criteria that we have to look at. And it's just not, you know, the building itself. It's just a lot of other things. And we were very fortunate that they came out that day. I want to thank the superintendent and everybody that's involved, the teachers, the kids. I mean, these gentlemen went over and talked to the students, just went, and they were amazed on how the enthusiasm that they're asking these kids, and they just couldn't believe it. So there's a lot involved in this. We've tried it 3 times. You know, we're competing against the worst of the worst, you know, whether it be a Holyoke, a Chicopee, a Springfield, a Brockton. You know, we've got a structure here that's kind of second to none, but yet it's an old concrete building, and you really can't do a lot with it. You've got to build on the inside. And they gave us a lot of tips, and the superintendent and her staff are going to get together. And we had somebody taking a lot of notes there, and pictures. And, you know, I'm proud of this place. I mean, when they said they couldn't believe nobody's walking around, and in the classroom, everybody is doing something. And not only that, the teachers came over and talked to them, the students, everybody. I just want to thank everybody that was involved, and not just the people that are here now, the people over the years that have taken pride in this building. You know, remember, we've had a preventative maintenance program here that's kind of second to none. And, you know, and that budget really never gets out of control with us. Occasionally, we'll call and ask for something, but I'm proud of it, and thank you very much.
Well, one thing, it's kind of a catch-22 in a way, mainly because we have the school, not us. I mean, the school has maintained it. You know, the fact of the matter is that the wiring, the air conditioning system, all the other parts of the building are still 40 years old and really need to be upgraded. So we've done the best we could. We put a new roof on. Then, as opposed to something that happens like over Newburyport, where they just discovered that the roof is structurally unstable, and there's a chance that it could, you know, under fatigue, could collapse. So if you're on the Building Association Committee, who are you going to address first? So we're in a pool of a lot of areas that where the buildings, even though they might be the same age we are, they show the age much more readily. And therefore, you know, we're going to have to, now that we know the whole crux, which, you know, you're right, maybe we should have known 2 years ago, but, you know, we felt that just by us being that age and, you know, the electrical, you know, there aren't wires hanging out of the walls like there are down in New Bedford. So then, you know, and, of course, some of this gets politicized. You know, you have people that are putting pressure on, and if you have 15 state representatives from, you know, Lawrence or Lowell putting the pressure on, we have two, you know, it's going to be tough, but yes.
I just wanted to say, aesthetically, if you walk through this building, you see a very, very bright cafeteria. We have done work to the gymnasium. We've done work outside, and even our room and the restaurant. We keep doing work, as Dick said. It's a wonderful maintenance program. But again, we're talking about a 45-year building, but it's not going to compete with the big cities, and that's where probably most of the money is going when they're dealing with buildings that are very, very old.
I also agree with Russ in a way. We kind of walked into this a little bit optimistic, I would say. Yes.
How many, do we know the average number of attempts per, when a school is going for this? Is it 3 times, 4 times, 5 times before
I don't know. I can tell you when we met with MSBA, part of the major criteria is urgency. So, like, a roof is falling in, or there's some structural damage, or, and then the next criteria, I think, is crowding. So most schools never get, we're probably in that three range, you know, that four range. So that's the problem. There's only so much money. And last year, I believe he said 79 people applied and only 14 got in. So I feel very thankful that the two people that came out from MSBA, one is the in charge of MSBA and the other is the chief of staff. And they were wonderful and they gave us some really good suggestions. And I feel very positive. What we have to do here is show a better sense of urgency. You know, I think sometimes we walk around here with a sense of pride of look what we did. And I think that, you know, that probably isn't the time to do that. We really need to show them, you know, what's going on with our system. So
a perfect example is, and Tony can verify this, when I was on the Amesbury School Board, you know, everything was going along great. And all of a sudden, some of the students were getting sick from the Cashman School. So we organized a committee and did an investigation and found out that in the walls and in the ceilings was mold everywhere.
Yeah.
They got the money the next year. It's, you know, and I think, you know, we're going to get it. We just have to persevere.
Help the kids trash the
school. Yes, Dick.
Yeah, this comes down to hardship and urgency. Our problem is we've got to have at least 30 things compared to other schools might only have three or four. I mean, you know, we could take them into the electrical rooms, you know, stuff that's 40, 45 years old that Harry's, you know, just band-aiding. You take them to the burn it, where the burners are. They don't make any of that stuff anymore. But yet, we have to make a hardship, and I believe the staff here is going to do a great job on it. And the good part about it is we're on a level playing field, too, which is great for us, too, and the students. And like I said, our preventative maintenance program is second to none right now, which, you know, we've given them the money, but they didn't just use it crazy. I mean, you walk through, you can't believe this place is 40, 45 years old. Well, anyways, great job to the superintendent and the staff and everybody else that's been here over the years. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I'm not disappointed. I think because of what you've done and what we've done through the years has put us in this conundrum, as they call it, but
exactly.
I'm not disappointed that they think we have a great school.
Yeah. You know, it's unfortunate that if we had let things go, we probably would be in the pipeline.
I get it.
You know?
You know, I'm not disappointed that
yeah.
they thought you guys have done a great job.
Yeah. And really, Harry
it's
has.
But it's you guys. It really is. I think it's great.
Harry and his staff. Yeah.
Anyway. Anything else on that? I think we need a motion to accept the goals.
Make a motion.
Second.
Any other comments on the goals? I think they're quite ambitious.
Smart goals.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Unanimous. Thank you. Yes, Ms. Lynch.
Okay, before you, I have a few scholarships. So I have the James Marino, the Kathleen Moynihan Marino Award, A Bright Promise. This scholarship is for $500 and will be given to a junior who's standing as one of the top 10 students in his or her class and shows A Bright Promise.
Move to accept.
Good question.
Yes.
Can I ask why a scholarship is given to a junior? How would they use it? Would it be banked until they go on to college?
Yeah. A gift to Whittier, Bright Promise. The only requirement I have as a student is to be gifted the award. Should be one whose class demonstrates him and her as one of the top 10 students. Composite of administration, as stated.
It did say junior, I know.
Yeah.
I read it.
Well, it is right here.
Yeah.
Help face.
Scholarship file will be given to
a junior. Mr. Chair. Applications.
I was just going to say that.
What?
I'll pay for college applications.
It could be for
okay.
It could be for college applications. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like $50 more than a patient on the common.
Okay, I just, I didn't know how they would use it.
That's a very valid question.
But that would allow them to.
Thank you.
I do like the fact now that we're, under scholarships, we're designating if they're annually, just for 1 year. And this is going to be every year, $500.
It's reoccurring, yep.
Okay, any, we need a motion for this, right?
Oh.
Need a motion for the scholarship.
Move to accept.
You did? All in favor, please say aye.
Oh, yes.
All opposed, unanimous.
Okay, before you tonight, I also have a scholarship from the Newburyport 5 Cents Savings Bank donating $1,000 scholarship to benefit a graduating Whittier senior. And I'd like to thank Janice Morse, President of CEO Bank, and the Newburyport 5 Cents Savings for this generous scholarship.
So moved.
Second.
Any questions on the scholarship? None being heard, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Unanimous.
Also today, Haverhill Bank is donating two $1,000 scholarships to benefit a graduating senior. I'd like to thank Thomas Moonmore, President and CEO of the bank, and the Haverhill Bank for these generous scholarships.
Move to accept.
Second.
Second.
Second, Ms. Cook. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, unanimous.
Also today before you, I have a field trip, an overnight field trip, March 9th through 11th at the Marriott Copley Hotel. This is a DECA state competition.
Move to approve that.
Second.
Any questions on that?
We have the paperwork in order?
We will have all the paperwork.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, unanimous.
I'd also like to let you know about an outside project, a new outside project in Merrimack. The carpentry, they're building a shed for the Merrimack Council on Aging. It is being built in the carpentry shop and will be installed in the spring. And that's all I have for you tonight.
Thank you very much for the exclusive report. Next on the agenda item is the principal report. Mr. Laganis.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Superintendent Lynch, and the rest of the school committee members, and Happy New Year to everybody. Just a few tallies from that holiday fund. We raised for our students and families that were having difficult financial times, it was $5,087. This was done through the help of many staff members, some local agencies, including Lions and Rogers, the Haverhill Kiwanis Club, UPS, and the Embroidery Loft that made clothes for our students. We were able to accommodate 63 students and their families. So quite an accomplishment. I just want to go a special thanks. Goes out to Cheryl Began, Christine Morrison from our guidance department, our guidance team, and Charlie Early, our security guard, and many other staff members who shopped, wrapped, and delivered and contributed to this fund. So it was very rewarding in the end. Students, believe it or not, are preparing for midterms next week. And vocational academic exams will be taken January 17th through the 20th. During this time, administrative staff work with freshmen on career plans. Various topics will include college and career readiness, portfolio development, peer mediation, extracurricular activities. Also, the freshmen will be listening to a guest speaker panel presentation, all Whittier alumni, on career opportunities and non-traditional roles. I also want to send off a special thanks to Bev DeSalvo, the vocational coordinator, who kind of spearheads and organizes this event. In the next couple months, we'll start looking to update the program of studies in order to build the master schedule for next year. Also, our booster club for our student athletes is running another fundraiser. And 2 years ago, I believe, we had this fundraiser. It's a mattress fundraiser. And that's going to be on January 21st on a Saturday from 10 to 5. And I believe 2 years ago, it brought for our student athletes about $3,000 plus, which is excellent for our school, sports programs. And that is, again, from January 21st on a Saturday from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m.
What is that?
It's a fundraiser that they, it's, they bring in, and I have flyers if anybody's interested, that they come in and they actually advertised yesterday, and they talked to all our athletes, and then we advertise to all the communities. And if you want to come in and buy a mattress on a cheap discount rate, they bring it in, and they, and part of it goes to our Whittier, a certain percentage goes to our Whittier students. So it was something, I know Ms. Lynch is the former principal, that she spearheaded this 2 years ago, and we were able to make, you know, quite a bit of dough for the children.
So that's amazing.
We're hoping, you know, and hoping our student athletes will get the word out there. And you know, Mr. Regan can probably attest that you were at the meeting.
Oh, yeah.
So well, hopefully we'll get it out there. And again, it's up to if you, again, it's up to anybody where we have, you know, our teachers, if you want a mattress or any of the school committee members, feel free to, you know, get involved. And I can send off the flyer. I can give some to Ms. Lynch to send out or via email or whatever it may be if you're interested. So look out for that. We do have, by the way, we do have two females on the wrestling team. I texted Harry, and actually they won tonight against Greater Lawrence, which was quite a feat. So that's it for me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
I just wanted to ask about the Whittier alumni that are going to speak. Is that going to be videotaped by any chance?
I'm not sure. I believe I want to say that Mr. Priscelli does videotape that. He's usually pretty good like that in videotaping just everything, especially the alum that come in. We have you know, some of the sort of the same nucleus of the panel that comes in every year to talk to the kids. But it's really fabulous to see them and in the careers and what they're doing, and the kids love it.
Oh, okay. And how are they, the ages, are they established, like older folks that are?
Yeah, I mean, some that are right out of, you know, some that are right out of Whittier, some that are very established, that have been in the workforce or in college or whatever it may be, you know, that they're going to talk to them, their route and their path and the way they went, so.
It just might be interesting to have excerpts on the website,
yeah.
You know, of what the, you know, mm-hmm.
But we also, you know, we have the peer mediation and, you know, this, and then all the extracurricular activities and different times. Beverly DeSavo, she has them coming in and during the day to, you know, it's called the halftime show for our freshmen.
I think it's a great idea.
Yeah, exposing them to everything.
It's a great idea. Thanks.
Thank you.
That's great.
Thank you, everyone. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Next up. I might have skipped this next one.
You want me to sit down?
Yeah. Ms. Cosmos.
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Superintendent Lynch, and members of the committee. Happy 2017. I hope everyone enjoyed their holidays. It's hard to believe, but I have in your packet a 6 months variance report, which encompasses July through September. Mm-hmm. I also have included a mid-year transfer request. I think at the last variance report, I mentioned that typically around halfway through the year, I do some salary realignments. And in this report, I also added the two columns, which I've done in the past, which show the transfers, where they'll go in and out, so you can see a visual of it and see how it will align some of those lines. And just, you know, people often wonder, well, why do you have to do these adjustments? And it's very simple. We're now preparing next year's budget now. So when I prepared with the superintendent and the school committee last year's budget, we were working in January for our needs this year. And at the time, when, especially with salary, we take the staff we have on hand at that time and we project where they're going to be in the next year for their salary and their benefits and all that. What is unknown is who's going to retire. Well, we might know one, but sometimes they make the decision after the budget. Who's going to leave? And who's going to go back to school for credits and you know, progress on the salary scale. So typically around this time, everything kind of settles down, and it's a good time to make those salary alignments. So the mid-year transfer will adjust those salary accounts to those changes. And also for similar reasons, there are various fluctuations in the expense accounts, but we usually clean those up at the end of the year because, again, the needs are greater. They change. The salary kind of stays consistent through the year, but the expenses can change, especially after mid-year when they choose their trades and the enrollments shift. So, but what you can see is at the bottom of the variance report, I do provide the accounts that are in the negative and how much we would have available in accounts that are positive. And you can see that the accounts that are positive more than offset any accounts that are negative. So I would entertain any questions and ask, hopefully, that you approve the transfer at this point.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I move the approval of the transfer request to balance the instructional and clerical salary accounts at mid-year in the amount of $111,516.
Second.
Any questions on all the transfers? None being heard, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Unanimous. Yes.
I have a quick question. On engineering, I see it's $24,000, but why is it we didn't have zero at
We didn't have a budget because we were anticipating that the Perkins grant would cover the new engineering program. Unfortunately, we didn't get enough grant money, so we had to pick up the expenses in the district. And again, that's one of the things at the end of the year that I will clean up and use available balances from other funds.
And I noticed another thing, not just the computer supplies and the network, but a lot of different computer things were negative. How is that being balanced?
Well, there are a lot of overages in other accounts. Well, part of the computer is we're waiting on E-rate money.
Okay.
We had to front the money for the cabling over the summer, and we're waiting for the reimbursement from E-rate to come in, and that will go in and offset that. So I do expect the technology accounts to come into the positive. It's just a timing and waiting for the money to come in from the federal. Anything else?
Okay. Great job to the superintendent, the staff, and everybody else that making this work. Thank you.
Thank you. And yes. I just wanted, I'm sorry.
Well, I just had another question for the treasurer. The manager. I continue to be impressed at the amount of scholarships that we receive. Mm-hmm. Almost every month we're receiving several thousand dollars. Where do we account for that in our budget so that if we wanted to look and say, well, we got $10,000 this year or 20. I mean, do you have separate lines for every different scholarship we get, or is it a fund?
It depends. First of all, if you were to go to your treasurer's report, the page beyond the page where the treasurer gives you the balances of the funds and the interest in the warrants, there is a summary with a bunch of lines, and it will say district and student activity, and it shows you the school choice account. We added the scholarships to that line. I have a hard copy, actually. So if you were to go...
All right, well, it's in there.
It should be page 2 of that treasurer's report.
Right here.
And you'll see those... Just built at the bottom of the page, just above the E&D, it says scholarships and donations, and it will show you the beginning balance. We started this year with an endowment of $232,631. To date, we've received $22,116. We haven't paid any out yet because we won't until May or June, and so we have an existing balance of $254,748. Yeah. We account for them in two different ways. If they are an established endowment, which some of them are, they have significant amount of money, and they either gave us a lot of money up front or they continue to fund it, like the Margarito Scholarship is one that has been funded continuously for about 20, 25 years. They have their own account. Other ones that we ask for every year, such as the Newburyport 5 Cents Savings Bank and Haverhill Bank, go into a grouping of accounts, scholarships. So we account, but they all are accounted for. We do have spreadsheets. And just this year, I started reporting it to you so that you would at least see what we have and what is available. But it's not all available. Some of them have very specific rules on how much we can give. So even though it looks like we have $254,000 to distribute, we can't necessarily distribute $254,000 because some of them are endowments, and they only allow us to distribute X amount of dollars every year. Does that help?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes, thank you very much. I needed a little refresher course.
Are there any other questions on the variance report?
Are you planning to set up a scholarship account?
Mm-hmm. Just one more thing to follow up. I told
yes.
you that I would at the last meeting. The bleachers mm-hmm. are fully installed, as Ms. Lynch said, and with the exception of some seating and loaming that will happen in the spring we should be done with that project. I was unable to bring you the bid on the chiller tower, as I said I would, to let you know where we are with the additional monies we had and how we are using them to repair, because the bids came in right before the holidays and we have not had a chance to get the contract out to the low bidder and get it signed back. So I expect to be able to tell you how it all fleshed out at the next meeting. Okay, any questions? Thank you all so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The next on the agenda is Chair's report. In January tonight, we did discuss the no policy updates. We're doing pretty good on that. Various analysis we just reviewed. Beginning of the meeting, we, under superintendent report, we discussed the budget. I'll have more to say on that in my report. And we passed and voted upon the update on the goals of the superintendent. So next month will be a February meeting. The only thing on the docket right now is the budget review again. The executive board will meet between now and the next meeting, so there'll be an update on the budget. Under subcommittee reports, executive, the executive committee met tonight to discuss the budget for the next school fiscal year. And we report a couple of things that we discussed, which are going to be have some impacts on the budget. First of all, one of the two major things that are going to impact the budget this year, one will be the medical costs. Medical costs are anticipated from our trust fund, which handles the medical. That could be going up as high as 10% in the medical costs. This could, we don't think it will reach that much because we're looking at some self-funding, but this could reach as much as $600,000 additional cost to the budget under the medical. Secondly, another impact to the budget, as we know each year, with full enrollment, choice funds in are going down. This year, anticipated choice funds for next year are down to $120,000. I don't know if you all recall, but when I first came on board, it was over $1 million choice each year. So this will probably be the last year. Because of that, some of the positions that were being funded under choice are going to be relocated into the regular expense budget of Whittier to the $296,000. So that'll increase the budget there. Then we have some of the other issues that we're dealing with. The subcommittee discussed briefly some issues that might to be investigated on different ways to fund the medical costs. There's some alternatives that will become available to us in the future in regards to some self-funding issues, some increase in the deductibles. So there's some plans out there that are being looked at where the deductibles per individual go as high as $5,000, and that cuts the medical yearly costs in half almost. And I don't know if everybody understands here, but it's right around $18,000 a year per individual for the family plan. And based on, we're going to do some study on that, based on the history and the usage of the medical plan by the group. You know, a lot of these towns, mostly in the south now that I'm investigating, they fund the deductible as they're saving $2 or $3 million of dollars on the premiums. So when you decide how many people would use that based on your a pool of individuals. You know, we're also looking at some other issues. We also understand that one more year, we contract negotiations, and we'll have to take a look at that. But, you know, right now, and we'll get all these figures at the next meeting when we get down closer to our goals, you know, the fixed charge, and mostly medical, is $5.2 million. So it's a big part of the year. $22 million budget. You know, we're also looking briefly, be more in depth as we get closer, to the scale on the chart for the steps. I've been doing some studies on the incremental increases per step to see how much the actual increases are, and you know, over the years that has increased. You know, 10% of 2,000 is not the same as 10% of 20,000. So, you know, we're going to be looking, but we're looking at those are between the payroll, administration, and the school staff, along with the medical. It's almost 52% of the budget. So. Yes, sir.
Do we have the ability to join the municipality GIC program that's open to the municipalities?
We do. And we.
Do we have that ability, Kara?
We would have to remove ourselves from the collaborative.
The trust.
The trust. Kara can speak to that.
We are part of the Mass Bay Health Trust, and so the trust has the option to go into the GIC, and that's actually come up at several of our discussions. But us as an individual school, as Mr. LaBella said, we would have to withdraw from the Mass Bay Health Trust, and we would have to go and make our own decision to do that. What that would involve, I don't know, and I don't know if we would necessarily save a significant amount. We've been very fortunate with the increases through the Mass Bay Health, and of course it's all dependent upon your usage and your claims. But we last year it was a 6% increase. A couple of years ago it was a 3% increase. A couple of years before that it was a 5% increase. So based on what I have learned from our surrounding communities, we have been very lucky and done very well with our premiums. But that's certainly always an option if things get out of...
I think the GIC is going up, predicted around 5% this year.
We went into a self-insured program this year, and we're hoping that that will allow us to achieve at least stabilized or minimally increasing premiums. But again, it depends on your population and how much they use it, which is what happens with everybody. But as part of the trust, we would have to do that as the trust.
Okay. I just want to see if that was something that we were looking at.
Oh, yeah. We will. I just want everybody to realize the direction we're going into. As far as maintenance and other contractual things, that's all minimal increase, but these have a major effect. And as Ms. Lynch said, they're around a little over 8%. We're going to instruct her to get it down to 5. Mm-hmm. And then from there, I think the executive board will then solicit, you know, input from everybody to see where we want to really try to end up. You know, I think last year we were 4.1%, and we ended up 4.1%. Yeah, but you know, it's the same thing. It's what you know. We strived, and one of our goals was to get all in district. We're there now, but you know, all that choice money that was used to offset some salaries and some equipment, now it's going into the general, and it had in the last 3 years. So. You know, to go from a million down to 120,000. You know, I think this graduating class will be the end of it, right?
Not this year, the next year.
Next year, I have no choice at all. So the school is at, you know, full capacity population-wise. You know, we have some. We'll be getting all this stuff out to you before the next meeting. Once we get this thing down around 5%, but. The actual population growth is among a lot of the smaller communities, which is, in a way, Mr. Earlier won't like to hear this, but it's a good thing because the smaller communities pay a larger enrollment cost than the Haverhill communities pay, because even though the formula is based on, what did you say, it was 26 different attributes or something like that, the main crux is each community's ability to pay based on capital, income, and real estate value. So, and we're going to try to formulate a five-year plan, hopefully, in the next year, on how to maximize our enrollment. Mr. Early.
I won't get into having everybody on Haverhill's shoulders for many, many years.
Well, we're going
years,
on new reports now.
The good part about it is, the last two or three years for Haverhill, we've got more enrollment with decreasing because nobody knows how this formula goes. The state doesn't know how this formula goes. It just happens to be in Haverhill's best interest for the last 3 years that we have getting more students, our costs are going down, and it's a great thing for us. But for many years, as everybody knows, they've been on Haverhill's shoulders. Thank you.
As you've let us.
The board will pick that up.
Then we will pick that up a couple of enrollments. But we have seen it. Haysbury used to be number two.
Yeah.
Haysbury's number three. Georgetown's number two, believe it or not, in enrollment.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Is that correct on that?
I think so. Salisbury.
No, Salisbury's going down.
We have 42 of that. Yeah.
I don't think it's Georgetown.
Is it Chuck?
I don't think it's Georgetown.
Merrimack.
Down too. Merrimack and Grover, excuse me, not Georgetown. But, you know, yeah, so most of the small communities have seen an increase. Of course, you know, if you have 20 and you bring in 5, it's, you know, 25% increase. And to them, it's kind of a major impact to their budget. The report's up 8 students, so it's $17,000 a student, but it's a good thing for us.
Thank you, Henry Ford.
Okay. Any questions on the budget update or the executives? Yes, Ben.
When do we receive the budget for review?
Well, we won't begin to that. I think it's under the schedule to end of March.
Can't get it in February, though.
You can come to the next meeting.
Yeah. Everybody's welcome to come to the executive board meeting.
Okay, but I mean, when are we going to get, is there a book with line items or?
Well,
we're
that's what we're working on right now.
Yeah. This is the first go-around executive board. They were instructed to bring it down to 5%. At our next school board meeting, we'll have the 5% issues, and then we'll get a general conclusion of where we want to end up. Then we'll get line items. And then that goes out to everybody. And then on before one of the school committee meetings, we have a workshop where everybody brings the budget to approve the budget, the final budget.
And
you have that at least 2 weeks before the meeting.
Is there a public hearing or anything like
that? Yeah, and after we do that, then in April we have a public hearing, and then we vote on the budget, and then we go around. We have to get every community to vote. We need 8 votes to pass the budget.
And then it goes to town meetings, right?
That's what I'm saying, we'll vote, yeah. And usually what happens is the town meetings vote first because the city, the three cities, their annual vote is usually in June. So the vote on the budget, usually by that time, we know if we're, you know, where the results are. Because most of the towns, they meet April, May, you know, a town meeting.
Yeah.
We go to each one, the superintendent, I try to attend as many as I can. The chair does whatever, and you know, answer questions. Any other questions? Okay, instruction personnel, Dr. Testaverde.
At this time, we have not had a meeting recently. However, we do need one coming spring, so we will be looking forward to setting a meeting within the next month and a half.
Mr. Tucker, plan operations.
Plan operations has not met.
Salary negotiations, Mr. Murphy.
Salary negotiations did meet on January 4th. You have the minutes in your packet, and I'd like to make a motion to approve.
Second.
I was trying to find the minutes in my packet. I couldn't.
They could be on your iPad.
Separate one.
Second mail.
Yeah.
The second mail. In the supplement packet.
Yeah. But it's also on the iPad.
And they're on the iPad. Did you get the second packet?
Yeah, I don't have it with me, so that's why I don't have it.
But basically, there'll be a full report. Just briefly, at the last school committee meeting, there were some questions were raised regarding the process of how salary in the negotiations committee met. So we postponed any formal vote, try to answer all those questions. We then scheduled another meeting, reviewed and changed the format of the salary, and it was open to anybody that wanted to come. And those that had questions, we tried to answer all the interests. So I think everybody received the packet in the mail. put the final proposal on the salary contract for the superintendent. Okay. Mr. Irvin.
Mr. Chairman, policy has not met. I believe we're good till spring unless something's come in.
I haven't seen any.
Probably April we'll have a meeting.
The only question I had, when we voted to make that change on the length of time for reporting any on the DWIs.
Oh, that's all been taken care
of. Yeah, but the unions have,
yes,
has no other issues.
Nope.
That's cool.
We're all set.
We're all set. Good to know. We have to vote on the minutes. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
It's executive minutes, January 4th.
Salary.
Salary minutes. Okay. Next meeting is February 8th. We'll have the first executive subcommittee. All are welcome to come. Put their input in, the more the merrier, at 5:30 p.m. right here. And then we'll have the regular school committee meeting on February the 8th, same night, at 7 p.m. Okay. And the new business. There ain't new business anybody wants to bring up. I do think we're going to, when do we schedule the report on the night school? Next one. So, based on that, I have to read. We do have a reason for executive session. So, we're going to need a motion to enter executive session to conduct contract negotiations with the non-union personnel. Superintendent in an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the position of the school committee. And upon completion of executive session, we will return to open session. Need a motion?
So moved.
Mr. Early?
Yes.
Mr. Woods?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah?
Yeah, yes. Whatever you want, Mr.
Yes.
Chairman.
Yes. Mr. Gilbert?
Yes.
Mr. Tucker?
No.
Yes. Yes. Mr. Irvin?
Aye.
It's not. Mr. Verdi?
Yes.
Yes.
Can I have a point of order? Are we going to have discussion on whether we're going to executive session?
Yes, we're doing that. We're going into executive session.
I emailed you on the previous meeting, and my concern is if the superintendent is in the executive session when we're discussing
right.
that, it negates the strategy component of the reason for going into executive session.
Right. And I think I answered that. Legally, if we're in executive session discussing somebody, to my
that's disciplinary or performance.
Is that?
So my
okay.
concern is if you go into executive session, and the superintendent's there, you don't have a negotiating strategy because the party is still there. So I think you're jeopardizing.
He is
that.
Correct that it
I
is.
I think you violate
is.
Open meeting law if you do it. So I'm just.
Strategy,
okay.
The employee is not invited to attend strategy. If it's regarding the performance of their duties or anything like that, the employee
right.
has to have notice
well,
and is invited.
Think of it this way. If you're doing it with your union
yeah.
staff, would you invite all union reps in at that time?
Oh, there's somebody that represents the union.
No, but those reps wouldn't be in your initial meetings where you're doing strategy.
But, okay, the other side of the coin is that the executive committee, the salary negotiations committee, which is supported by the total school board, met by themselves for strategies based on the last meeting, then met with the superintendent. So, see, so there was a meeting without the superintendent.
What I'm saying is I think...
What you're saying is that you want the whole
There's nothing that can't be discussed in
negotiate.
Public forum if the superintendent, the party you're negotiating with is in the meeting. What's the advantage of a executive session at that point? If all the parties are there, there's no benefit to protect the executive session.
Yes.
Well, I'm perfectly willing to discuss it in open session and vote in an open session. However, if we're in executive session, I think that you have the ability to invite whomever you feel would be pertinent to the discussion.
Well, my thought process is that the subcommittee has voted to make this proposal. This proposal will be given to the total school committee in executive session. We're not going to negotiate. You're going to vote yes or no. Because everybody had the opportunity to come to the negotiation meeting and voice their input. So now in executive session, we're not going to renegotiate what the subcommittee came up with. We're going to vote yes or no. If we vote yes, then we come back in open session and vote it. It's a done deal. If we vote no, then we don't vote it again in open session. Then we go back into negotiations.
I think his
We're not renegotiating.
You're right. I think his point of order would be if we didn't have that. Usually, at least from my experience, the full committee directs the subcommittee the parameters to negotiate with the superintendent.
And they've done
that.
Then
the subcommittee brings it back for a vote.
And that's what we are.
So I think that's, I think his point of order is thinking that that part wasn't done, I would guess.
It was done on January 4th.
I'm just guessing he was trying to.
I'm just saying by having the party you're negotiating with in the executive session, there's no strategy to be.
No, I agree. If you're talking strategy, you usually don't invite the party.
What I'm saying is the strategy is over. This is what.
But that's the reason you gave for going into executive session. So I think the.
No, it is. Subcommittee. We did that 2 months ago.
The reason you just gave is to negotiate.
What came in your packet.
Strategy with respect to collective bargaining and litigation if an open meeting might have a detrimental effect. That's the reason for going into an executive session.
Wow.
Okay.
I think it may have been worded wrong on the agenda.
This might be worded wrong.
Though. It is.
I apologize for that.
Well, so then what's.
So technically.
We're going into the executive session to act on the recommendation of the negotiation subcommittee.
Technically, just for as a point of order, it wasn't posted correctly if this is the way it was posted.
We are going conducting contract negotiations with non-union personnel superintendent to discuss.
It says we're going to conduct contract negotiations with non-union, the superintendent.
Yeah.
If we're just going in for, it's kind of.
Well, that's an error then.
It was posted incorrectly, so.
Posted.
I think he's. Caught that or whatever.
You're right.
No, it isn't even that. I just think there's no need for an executive session if the parties are all there. I think you're violating open meeting law at that point.
Well, I would say that you're probably correct about that, but the way that it's posted.
You're dealing with personnel.
I just think you could get in trouble. Would you?
You're dealing with personnel.
Why can't we have a session?
Yeah. I don't know. I'm honest with you. I apologize.
I think where it's posted incorrectly, just my personal opinion, everyone else has theirs, I would post it correctly and do it that way, or I think we may be in violation of the open meeting law.
That's the problem.
Well, then we won't go into executive session.
I was just going to suggest that's that. Why do we have to go into executive session?
We don't. That's what I'm saying. It should
What's
be
voted unless
I'm right again. No executive session.
We'll vote for it.
Do it right now.
So we'll just
do it.
Everybody has what was.
Yep.
So if it's not on the agenda, I think you would need a suspension of the rules in order to put it on the agenda, because it's not on the regular agenda. So you need a motion for a suspension of the rules to add the item to the agenda, and then do it that way, because it wasn't listed for the public.
Suspension of rules at this time.
Who's second?
Dick.
Any discussion on the motion?
Want to take a roll call?
Yeah, it has to be a roll call.
It has to be a suspension.
Yes.
Mr. Wood.
Yes.
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 Aye.
Yes.
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 Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Okay. Motion passed. Unanimous.
So for the record, we are still in public meeting and we're under suspension of the rules to discuss the superintendent.
Now we're going to discuss the superintendent's proposal by the salary negotiation committee on the superintendent's contract.
I think we need to make that clear for the minute.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes. Everybody got the information. But the contract.
Is it just that one page matrix?
Yes. But you got the contract. So we're voting on that.
No, we didn't get the contract.
We didn't get a contract.
They gave him out the last meeting?
We gave him out the last meeting.
Oh, I wasn't at the last meeting.
They've been around.
Okay.
I meant the finalized contract proposal. Do we have a copy of that?
Well, nothing changed in the contract except for the salary.
Okay.
Which is what you have.
Well, yeah, it did, Charlie, because we have suspended year three and made year three year one.
Right.
And so there was a bit of a change.
Does everybody understand that? Okay. The superintendent had a three-year contract. She's going into a third year. But she has to go on the contract negotiation. So she approached the salary as with the accordance with the policy and we went into negotiations, the state negotiations committee. She asked for a 5-year contract. We met, we decided that 5 years was a little bit more than we wanted to do. So we thought about it, and we came up with a proposal that we would give her a 4-year contract. We would amend her current contract, discontinue the 3rd year, which is next year, and put in the 1st year of a new contract for 4 more years, which would then give her 5 years. But really, it's a 4-year contract. We then went into some salary negotiations. We did an analysis of surrounding communities, and based on her performance, and when we hired her, upgrading her from a principal to a superintendent, we brought her in at the low end of the salary scale, saying that based on her performance, we would then try to get her to the medium salary range in 5 years on this contract, which is really 4 years. So based on that, we had a schedule for the next 5 years, including the last year of a contract. There was some concern that to do that, some of the percents weren't palatable to either other communities or especially to some of the staff that would see some of these increases. So based on that, the committee came up with six different scenarios. We met, they discussed, and they voted, the 3 members that were there voted unanimously on option number 3. So that's what's on the table tonight.
Can I ask a...
That's what we're voting on.
Can I ask a question, Charlie?
Yes, sir.
The previous proposal also addressed, there's an annuity component of the contract, too. When you read the contract, there's...
Tax-sheltered annuities.
Right.
Right.
There's salary, there's the tax-sheltered annuity,
right.
There's $3,500 a year for insurance provision, right. And there's $1,000 for longevity, it's called.
Right.
Those things make up the total compensation right. package. All this is addressing is the salary.
Right.
The previous proposal addressed increases to the TSA.
Right. So that won't change.
So that stays as is. So she only that only happened for 2 years, and then it goes away?
And that'll be renegotiated when that's over. Yes.
Number 3. Yeah.
Wait, explain that again,
Charlie. Her current contract has a provision for TSAs for 3 years. So we're going to hold fast to the 3rd year, which is, I think, $2,500, right?
Mm.
What's that?
What is it?
$15,000.
Addition, I'm talking about.
Yes.
Okay. Then we'll negotiate a TSA from then forward.
So,
but,
on top of the scenario, there's additional funds?
Well, it's part of the TSA. We can negotiate nothing. Keep it at $1,750. Yes.
Well, I think some of it, at least usually, you have the amended contract in front of you so everybody can look at it and see exactly. So I think that's probably some of the confusion. Let me say that I think the superintendent's doing an outstanding job. My evaluation reflects that I think she's doing an outstanding job. I just took a quick look at the 5-year projection. There's some assumptions in this one which aren't correct. Like, I can only speak for Haverhill. It assumes a 2% increase. We just signed a contract with a 0% increase. We also don't have any other benefits besides whatever the base salary is in our contracts. Some of these are incorrect.
The projection is based on 2% premium.
Right. What I'm saying is we have a signed contract going out that doesn't have.
How long is that?
We are through FY, through the next fiscal year now. So
you have
FY
a 1-year contract at 0.
Well, we already have a contract through this, through another year, and then we added another year onto that.
At
0%. Okay.
But you can't foresee what's going to happen after that.
No, I can't.
Okay.
But I can tell you that we don't do any other benefits in our contracts besides the base salaries. That's what we do. Anyway, having said that, I do support an extension for the superintendent here. However, I have always, and it is my firm stance, that I don't believe in giving any department head or superintendent longer than a 3-year contract. I just have always believed that that's, I've had that belief for 14 years. I just don't believe it's good for business. I wouldn't support it for any superintendent or any type of department head. I don't believe in a contract longer than the 3-year term. That's just my personal opinion. What was that? I think it takes away your accountability factor when you get into long-term contracts like that. Not that I, taking the individual out of it, I just have a general opposition to the, I think she's doing an outstanding job. That is, well, I only speak for myself, not everybody else. And that's an opinion I've been steadfast on, has absolutely nothing to do with her performance. I wanted to make that clear. I think she's doing an outstanding job. It has to do with the fact that I think that long-term contracts are generally bad for cities, towns, school districts, etc. That's my opinion. Thank you.
Charlie?
Yes, sir.
I'd like to address the 5-year, because in Pawtucket we went through the same situation, and we did give a 5-year contract, because when you get an outstanding person, you want to keep that person.
That's right.
And to find a good superintendent, and I'll say, I think Maureen is fantastic. Maybe I don't like some of the numbers in the contract, but I think if you do less than 5 years, it's you get somebody good, you keep them. There's no reason not to. And
the contract only ties you one way, though.
It
ties your hands. They can leave whenever they
want. That's correct. But you want to keep. You want to motivate that person to stay here. Try and find another good superintendent out there, because we went through the search, and I think we had Mike.
I can attest to that.
We had 84 applicants, and we whittled it down. And to find a good
shortage of qualified applicants.
There's lots of them out there.
You'll get
plenty of applications. So I think 5 years is something you really ought to think seriously about, that component of it.
Because my feeling is, part of the rationalization was, to be honest, is that we're going to hopefully, I'm going to be optimistic, we're going to get into the cycle for the new school. You know, the upgrade to the business. We have a person here that knows the school. It's a lot of work, extra work for a superintendent. And, you know, halfway through, we give her 2 or 3 years, she ends up going somewhere else for more money. You know, in today's day and age, in the last 15 years, the life tenancy of a superintendent has gone down from 18 years to 5 years. So, and I don't know whether it's the stress of the job or whatever it is, but superintendents aren't hanging around because they can walk around the corner. I agree with Chris, you know, there's not that many good applicants. They can almost write the wrong ticket. So, I know, you know, you don't believe in it, and you gave your guy a 1 year zero. Personally, if someone came to me and someone giving you a 1 year zero, you know what? My pen will be getting going.
Mm.
You know? Because to me, but then again, maybe your committee feels, and I'm not trying to tell you how to run your committee, you know, maybe you have another plan somewhere. That, you know,
but they have a different situation.
A different situation.
Yeah, they have
but
a
here,
very different situation.
Yeah, but I don't want to get into that. You know, this is, we got to think about Whittier.
Yeah, I'm thinking, and I'm saying my fundamental opposition is any department
head.
I don't care wherever I was, I wouldn't vote for it.
Yeah, no problem with me. Yeah. Mr. Early.
You know, you're right, Scott. Only a business, you have to be on your game on a lot of things. And when you have an employee, and I've got one person 40-plus years, in fact, he's been with us 45 years, all right, to try to replace those people, they're not out there. Now, I'm not I don't have a big education in superintendent searches, but I was on a search for the trustee at Northern Essex, and I can remember when we went through that, went into a national search. You know, I pay taxes in Haverhill, but for a long time, that was a revolving door. We have a great superintendent in Haverhill now, and he happened to go on an extension. However, when you find a superintendent, whether it's a superintendent of a school or a superintendent or a vice president of a company, and he's good, you want them to focus on their job and not have to worry about all this other stuff. Every 2 years or 3 years, your contract's coming up. And that makes a big difference. And there is not a lot of superintendents out there, from what I'm hearing, and I talk to a lot of people. There's no superintendents out there for a regular school system, never mind a technical school system. And it's not a 5-year contract. It's an amendment or slash an extension to what we have right now. And I believe we have a good superintendent in place. We have a great review on a building we're trying to get, a new school or renovation, and there's a lot involved in this. So we don't want to just have to worry about every 2 years superintendent, or at least I don't want the superintendent to have to worry about that every 2 or 3 years. And I'm going to support this because I believe in 5 years, 4 years, whatever the number you want to do, whether it's 2%, 5%, these salaries are going to be $250,000. Now, you just said 4 years, 5 years, they're leaving. You're right, and they're retiring on it. And then they're going into private industry or getting an exemption from the state. And that's an honor for the person, you know, that is getting it. And it's also an honor for the person, the town or the recipient that's getting the person. So I am going to support this, and I'm proud of it. Thank you.
Mr. Tucker.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to move that the school committee accept the superintendent's contract as presented using salary schedule number 3 as presented by the subcommittee.
I'll second.
Second. Any more discussion? Well, I'll have, it's a roll call vote, right? Yes. Mr. Early?
Yes.
Mr. Woods?
No.
Lisa?
Yes.
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 Yes. Mr. Tucker?
Yes.
Yes. Chair votes yes. Mr. Irving?
Aye.
Yes.
Brent?
Yes.
Chris?
Yes.
Join
yes.
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 And I would just thank ask, you. The next yes. meeting, could we have a clean copy?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
We'll have a copy of the contract?
Yes.
Thank you.
Is there any more discussion on this?
Yes.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
Aye.
I think.